I want to welcome all of you to the business forum today. My name is Lynn Snodgrass. My husband and I own Drake 7D's Garden Center and Landscape Company, and I'm the current president of the Gresham Area Chamber of Commerce. I'm really pleased to be here today, and I have bad S's and bad P's, so are they working out okay for you? Okay. I wanted to introduce, I have a lot of introductions, so bear with me, but I first want to introduce my fellow board members that are in attendance today. Representing the Boeing Company, we have Yvonne Mills. Yvonne, where are you? Yvonne, thank you for being here. She's also on our finance committee, so anything that goes over, you can blame her. We have, as well, representing the Gresham Barlow School District, Athena Vadnas. Athena, there you go, Athena. And we have Warner Allen, who is our president-elect. He's my Joe Biden. He's right here. He's with Warren Allen, LLP. That's short for attorneys. Representing the city of Gresham, we have Greg Matthews. You'll hear more about Greg later. Where are you, Greg? There you go. He doesn't think he has to sit with the rest of us. He is a fairly new board member. We're really pleased to have him. I also have John Maloney here from PGE. He's an executive board member for me. Thanks for joining us on the executive board, John. We appreciate you. And Matt Miller is the past president, and he's always late. So when he walks in, we can all recognize that he's here, and he's with Gresham Sanitary. He'll join us soon. Is your business disaster ready? Is your business disaster ready? It's all in how you say it, and that's what's going to make today's topic the wonderful and meaningful toolbox that it's meant to be. What happens when the unthinkable happens? Y2K was a really big deal disaster. I was speaker at the House at the time, and we really were prepared for Y2K. So were Drake and I. We bought all the water in the jugs. We had it in the pantry. We got dried food. We had the camp stove, propane. We even bought a generator. Well, how many of you did the same thing? Real common. Yeah, it's coming. We know it's coming, and so let's prepare for it. Well, over the last weekend, in preparation for this, I asked Drake if the generator even worked. I don't remember us even trying to see if it did work, but it looks really impressive in our garage, I'll tell you that. And since the garage is Drake's part of the house to take care of, I don't even think about it. But that's kind of like what disaster preparedness is like. It's somebody else is going to take care of it, and it's in that part of your brain that you really don't visit very often. Well, unlike having a baby and getting pregnant, where you know that pain of labor is going to be about 9 months away, you don't know when the pain of a disaster is coming. It could be moments, it could be minutes, it could be months away, but we don't know. What we do know is that pain could last forever. We're not going to have a cute little baby to hold, but years and years of recovery instead. In fact, many of us will not recover from whatever is up, ahead of us. So today is not meant to be doom and gloom, not at all, but it is meant to put tools in our toolbox so that we can use them. Providing the funds for that toolbox that you're about to enjoy are our sponsors. Now, no matter what the size of the company, for every dollar that comes in, and notice I didn't say profit, for every dollar that comes in, there are hundreds of places that our businesses could spend that money. And I am so grateful that the sponsors today have chosen to invest in the chamber and make today's event possible. Now, I'd like you to hold your applause so that you can keep eating and not have to stop and applaud and stop and applaud. So you can keep eating if you hold your applause. So I want to introduce you to all of our sponsors today. And at the end, we'll give them all a round of applause, and then we won't have that applause meter going on as who's more popular, okay? So what I'd like to do is first to recognize our community sponsor, who is Frontier Communications. Jason Mocha is the general manager of Frontier Communications in Gresham, and he is a veteran. In fact, Frontier has the business plan of having 30% of their entire workforce be veterans. Locally, we're at 28%, so that's great. Don't applaud for that, but remember that when we're at the end. And who better to help answer the call than veterans trained in emergencies? Frontier is the sixth largest local exchange carrier and the fifth largest provider of DSL based on coverage area in the United States. And don't tell anybody, but they have a really important communication building right here in our city, in Gresham. But don't tell anybody, okay? Is there any press here? That's wonderful. We so appreciate Frontier for investing in today, for investing in Gresham, and for investing in veterans. Our welcome sponsor is a household name. You all know it. Willamette Falls Electric. All right, so that was the name that they gave themselves in 1888. They're now known as Portland General Electric. They've been independent for all but 9 brief years in their 127 years of existence. 44% of all inhabitants in Oregon, 44%, are customers of PGE. Now that's really important when the Super Bowl is on. Not so much Monday morning after daylight savings, but I still appreciate what they do. Their community involvement focuses on 3 areas: education and workforce, environmental stewardship, and safe and healthy families. Why safe and healthy families? What does that have to do with PGE? Well, it's the right thing to do, so that's what they've done. Safety comes in all forms, especially at a young age, and they see the focus and the priority there. That's why PGE commits dollars and personal hours of training to school children and their teachers, making sure that safety is repeated over and over again, even at a young age. PGE is generous. They're generous in allowing someone like John to join us on the executive board, and they're generous in their ideas. Without their idea of disaster preparedness, we might be talking fashion. Well, maybe not, but I appreciate the generosity of, of PGE. We have 4 supporting sponsors. The City of Gresham is one. The City of Gresham started in 1905 when Mayor Bemis was just a wee tyke. Actually, Mayor Bemis had a very powerful State of the City address this past week, and he focused it on children and families. Today is about protecting children and families in their homes, their schools, and the workplace. With 110,000 residents to worry about and to protect, Mayor Bemis, our council members, and City Manager Eric Kvarstedt are making sure emergency preparedness is on the agenda. The Chamber is grateful for our strong partnership with the City of Gresham and with their willingness to participate in today and make it a priority. I hope you all notice the big van, the water van coming in. We'll talk about that in a minute. All right, if you Google Gresham Sanitary on a website, you're going to find something really fun. This is their motto: your garbage is our bread and butter. Isn't that fun? It's a great motto. Locally owned since 1948, Mike Miller and his son Matt own the company. They deal with thousands of regular customers, city contracts, day-to-day business decisions like all of us, and they want the best outcome possible for all of Gresham residents and the businesses. And that's the reason why Gresham Sanitary is a generous sponsor at today's event. ServPro of Gresham is also a local company. It's a franchise locally owned by Dennis and Ellen Messforth. Licensed and bonded, which is important these days. Their motto is, quickly make it like it never happened. While they might be a smaller company than some of the rest represented today, they have a big impact at a time of great need. They are in the everyday business of disasters. Today's sponsorship is highlighting that everyday disasters are going to be small compared to the what if big one coming. They care about the safety of our community as well. And our 4th supporting sponsor is Day Wireless Systems, another locally owned company. I'm proud of that. An Oregon State graduate who grew up and is still living in Estacada, Gordon Day, started the company in 1969. The words lead by example are all over their website and clearly proven by their presence today. Their business plan shows 5 cultural pillars: initiative, integrity, accountability, respect, and loyalty. Thanks for being loyal to the Chamber today and accountable to our community by sponsoring today's event. Okay, we've got one more thank you, and I'm going to ask all of you to humor me. When I count to 3, I want all of you to put your knives and forks down and to wave at the camera. 1, 2, 3. Wave at the camera. Very good. Many thanks to MetroEast Community Media for taking their time today to videotape. We love our partnership with them and for them to videotape the presentation today. We'll let everyone know when it will be aired on cable access by going to the Chamber newsletter. Okay, now is the time to give a huge applause to all of our hardworking sponsors. Please do that. Bigger, bigger. There were seven of them. Thank you so much. There are tables around the room and outside. Please visit the vendors after the luncheon today and let them know how much you appreciate it. There's all kinds of information available, and they would encourage you to take that information with you. Okay, at this point in time, are all of our speakers done eating? I'm going to ask you to come up, and before I introduce Greg, we're going to watch our speakers parade up here and have a seat at the table. Do, 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 do. There's no stairs down there. Come on, the stairs are over here. Okay. This is that awkward silence that we didn't plan for. The logistics. Here we go. Yeah, any place. Not in alphabetical order, but you could do it in age. That'd be funny. Wouldn't it? No, it would not be funny. Okay. It would be funny to me, because I'm so young. All right, so thank you for not laughing. All right, facilitating our discussion today is one of our newest chamber board members. If you live in East County and you don't know this man, then perhaps you haven't been outside of your house in a decade or two, or you haven't read a newspaper. He is everywhere. Greg Matthews is his name. If he's not the MC of a local fundraiser, or dressed as a pirate reading to elementary school kids on Dr. Seuss Day, you can find him on a SWAT team, or working with at-risk kids at Camp Rosenbaum in the summer, or in his past, voting on legislation in Salem as a state representative. He even fights fires. And now he dons the hat of the fire chief of Gresham. As a soldier, he was recognized by the White House for heroic efforts at Grenada, having risked his life to save the lives of children. He came back to Oregon, to his hometown of Gresham, to settle down and to have a family. I think it's fitting today to have at the podium someone who has spent practically his entire adult life protecting Gresham, the Gresham community. And he isn't just a public safety professional. Greg and his wife, Suzette, are small business owners, and their business is local as well. They own a daycare center. Suzette and Greg are parents of three daughters? Three daughters. Good luck with that three-daughter thing. That might be the toughest disaster preparedness battle you have yet to fight, Greg. Please welcome to the podium Greg Matthews.
Well, thank you. That's quite an introduction. I'm Greg Matthews, and I am running for president. Just kidding. Thank you. Yeah, it is a disaster with three daughters. In fact, if you were to walk into the bathroom of my 14-year-old, you would agree with me that there's quite a disaster every morning when she walks away. I don't know how much eyeliner gets on her, but I know how much is left on the counter. So today we're going to talk about disaster and preparedness and whether or not your business is prepared for the disaster. And it's an important thing to listen to, because sometimes you think about disaster as just an earthquake and you can dismiss that. What's really the chance of that? Sometimes you'll think about a flood. Well, we're really not near the coast. Sometimes you'll think about other things, and then you realize, as the folks from ServPro can tell you, disasters come in many forms, in many different ways. And ultimately, what you have to do is prepare yourself for those things. Try to get a step ahead of the curve. Because if you go to chamber101.com, you'll see that, as they say, 40% of businesses don't reopen if they experience a disaster. Of those that do, within 2 years, 80% of those don't succeed. These are real statistics that are out there. Not to trouble you, just to get your attention for a moment. This is not doom and gloom. A lot of these things are preventable. And as we say in the fire service, if it's predictable, it's preventable. The other thing we say is chance favors a prepared mind. And also, failing to plan is planning to fail. You can't fail. You can't fail you. You can't fail your employees. You can't fail this community. We need to all be prepared. Today we have Todd Felix from the city of Gresham, Bill Nicholson, Senior Vice President for PGE, Kevin Jeffries, Oregon Insurance Division, Kelly Piper from U.S. Bank, Director of Emergency Management, and Amy Shlossman, the Chief Executive Officer with American Red Cross. These folks have dedicated some time for us, and so I'm going to bring them up one at a time. They all know their timeline. We're trying to keep this on a tight schedule because we value your time and the time you're spending with us today, because we know you have to get back to your businesses that are running successfully. In order for them to be successful, you need to be there. So we will hopefully have time for Q&A, but if not, please understand, all these folks are very accessible. I'm sure they'd love to entertain you afterwards if possible, but we'll try to get to your questions if time allows. With that being said, our first speaker is Todd Felix with the City of Gresham. He is the emergency management for the City of Gresham. If you recall back in the snowstorm in 2008, Todd was at the helm of that snowstorm in Emergency Operations Center. He's also been part of the H1N1 vaccination virus. You might recall that. He was also that was the influenza pandemic. 2010, the search for Kyron Horman, and in 2014, he is in the EOC for the active shooter incident at Reynolds High School. We're very lucky to have Todd in the city. Todd serves on many different boards. He's the chair of the Regional Emergency Managers Technical Committee, member of the Mountain Community College Cybersecurity Advisory Committee, and so many other things. He's been recognized numerous times with countless awards, and he is dedicated to serving this city, your business, our citizens. It's a real honor and a pleasure, a privilege for me to introduce Todd, if you would. And Todd, please consider the following question as you make your way to the podium. The U.S. Chamber of Commerce recently published a report that suggests that businesses play a vital role in a community's ability to recover after a disaster by providing local access to supplies, but also restoring a sense of normalcy. What are your thoughts about the role local businesses can play in preparedness and the recovery with the City of Gresham? That's for you, Todd, and please welcome to the stage, Todd Felix.
Thank you, Chief, very much. When I was contemplating that question, as we were going through the introductions, as Lynn was going through the introductions, I thought there's really no better way to answer that than to look back at her introduction that she did and talk about the companies that she mentioned, ServPro and Day Wireless and Frontier and PGE and all these other companies that are really the major response in any disaster. When you look at disaster recovery, it is not the government coming to the rescue. Okay, we coordinate our portion of that. The majority of disasters are really recovered through the private sector and through volunteers and through individuals. So we'd really like to thank Shelley for inviting us today and putting together such a great panel, because we have here many of those elements that I just discussed for you to ask questions towards the end, which I think is really the major part of a presentation like this, is being able to ask questions and get through things. What I'm going to talk about today, I'm going to talk about the hazards that we look at in Gresham. I'm going to focus on one hazard primarily, but really many of the principles really follow through to all the other hazards that we face. Has anybody here heard the term Cascadia subduction zone earthquake? So most people have. That is really the primary focus of emergency management these days and what we're planning for. If we focus on that and a few other hazards, we really put together many of the elements that it's going to take to address any hazard that we have going. So a Cascadia subduction zone earthquake, for those of you that don't know, is where the tectonic plates, the Pacific plate and the North American plate are colliding, and the Pacific plate is really dragging the North American plate down. And at some point, that snaps loose, and that's what the subduction zone earthquake is. Essentially, it's that snapping motion once it's done dragging the other plate underneath. And really, our situation here on the West Coast is very similar to the situation that Japan had a few years ago. And somebody reminded me today that it is the fourth anniversary of the Japan quake today. So it's very timely discussion for us to have on this. So I did put up here a few pictures of the other subduction zone earthquakes that have really happened in the world over the last 50 or 60 years or so. And probably the most prevalent two that we can really relate to are the Japan quake, as I said, it was 4 years ago today, and the Sumatra quake back in 2004, where the tsunami from that killed about 250,000 people. Very devastating, and really the tsunamis and the after effects of the earthquake are really what do most of the damage and the death and casualties during an event like this. It is not necessarily just the shaking. Our shaking here, which we'll discuss in just a moment, is moderate, but the real damage comes from the consequences of the earthquake, and we'll talk about those down the road a little bit. Everybody's probably heard the term ring of fire. If you look at that graphic in the upper left-hand corner there, it illustrates where some of the more major earthquakes have happened over the last, like I said, 40, 50, 60 years. And what you'll notice as you're looking at that, let's see if I can use this laser pointer right there, the Northwest has really had an absence of those major earthquakes. And that's not necessarily a good thing. That means at some point in the near future, we're going to be facing one of those. And really, this is a graphic from the Department of Geology that really depicts what our risk is, what the hazard is that we face. They break it up into size of Cascadia subduction zone earthquakes, from the largest on the left down to the smallest on the right. And you can see, depending on the size, the frequency is anywhere from 240 to 500 years. And it's been 315 years and about a month and a half since we had one. So it was January 26th in the year 1700 was the last time that the Northwest had a subduction zone earthquake like that. And they know that because there's Japanese folklore that talks about the Great Wave killing a lot of people in Japan from the earthquake that happened on our coast. So that was one of their major indicators, and there's some Indian folklore locally as well about that. And that timeline along there really shows how current they or how constant they are in their repetitiveness. And this is what's called a shake map. This tries to describe in some detail what it's going to be like for us or for a specific region within our state when we have an earthquake like that. And really in our area, we're going to, what they describe here is it would be difficult to walk. You're going to see things that are not very secure fall, maybe some chimneys, unreinforced masonry buildings will have difficulties, balconies, things like that are things that are not as structural as maybe the rest of your home or the rest of this building is. And those will be the things that we really have difficulties with in a structural standpoint. We are not going to be prone to a ton of collapsed buildings around here from an earthquake like this. Again, what we're really going to be suffering from is the consequences of it. So starting to talk about those consequences, has anybody at all looked through the Oregon Resilience Plan? I don't know if anybody's even heard of that. So a couple of people have heard about that. If you ever cannot sleep one night, it's a 340-page document describing in detail what the consequences are going to be for Oregon during a Cascadia subduction zone earthquake. They do have an executive summary of that, if you're interested. I think that's only 20-some pages, not nearly as bad, but it is out there. You can go to the State of Oregon Emergency Management webpage and search for it, and it'll come right up. So I pulled some information out of that to put this presentation together. So what they did is the Oregon legislature put together committees and an effort to really dig deep into what a subduction zone earthquake is going to look like for our area. And they brought in experts from every field, from transportation, from energy, from the medical sector, from public health, emergency managers, military, and they really dug in depth, probably the most in-depth study that's been done on a subduction zone earthquake in the United States, and put together this Oregon Resilience Plan. And these are some of the things that they came up with out of that plan. What they're looking at here for our area is somewhere between 1,200 and 10,000 casualties. That's a really big number. That's the scary part of this. Economic loss up to 20% of our GDP. That's very impactful. And then what they're saying is 1 million truckloads of debris. So another company that was mentioned in the onset of this was Gresham Sanitary Services. Another illustration of how all of these businesses are going to play a role in helping us recover from a disaster like that. So in Gresham, what can you expect to see here? So they broke out the consequences of this earthquake into zones. So they have the valley zone, they have the coastal zone, then they have eastern Oregon. And again, I pulled some information out of there, but not to be Mr. Doom and Gloom, like the chief said, what we're really trying to do is paint an accurate picture for you of what we could be facing here. What we could be facing here is a transportation system that looks like this, where highways are not up to full speed for 3 to 12 months. You know, maybe they'll be, I think what the number they use is up to 60% restored. Airports might not be usable for six to 12 months, and railroads for 1 to 3 months. Think about the amount of goods and services that get moved through those transportation services, and think about how do we get food, how do we get supplies to continue to conduct business, all those types of things. Those, again, as I said earlier, are really the impacts of an earthquake like this. So how will you get food and supplies for your home? Because if you're not prepared at home, it's going to be even less likely that you're going to be conducting your business, because you're going to have to be taking care of your family first. And same for your employees. So encouraging employee preparedness is really an important step as well. And again, how will you receive emergency services and just supplies for your business? This graphic on the right-hand side really talks about bridges and their construction and what codes they were developed and constructed to. And most of our bridges are really in poor condition. I sat through a meeting with ODOT about that subject, and they said they had 1,000 bridges they needed to retrofit. And at the speed that they were able to do it, given the funding that they have, it was going to be a 100-year effort to get those bridges retrofitted. Anybody see the construction going on the Troutdale Bridge on I-84 over the last couple of 2-3 years? That's what that was. That was one of the more important bridges that they looked at needing to retrofit, because it does bring in so much commerce and things into our area. That was another issue with the Columbia River crossing. That was one of my hopes for them replacing that bridge, was that if the current I-5 bridge goes down, that shuts off river traffic as well, and for a long time. So they still need to focus on getting that bridge replaced. Utilities and energy, and I'm sure Bill will probably talk about this a little bit as well. And I love this picture here. This is Japan. And look at this nice orderly line that they have for people to go and get supplies. I thought that was really funny, and it's kind of appropriate that we have our water trailer out here, because you might be seeing yourself in a line like that if you're not prepared yourselves to get to the water truck to be able to get a bag of water. So make sure you stop and look at that. There has been several of those trailers purchased through grant funds in the Portland metro region, and that's just one of many, many efforts that everybody's working on to try and prepare for things like this. But we're looking at not having completely usable water services for 6 to 12 months. That's a long time. That's really difficult. Most people probably don't have enough water in their house to serve themselves for more than a few days. So that makes it very difficult. 1 minute? Okay. My boss says 1 minute. So and same thing with utilities, 1 to 3 months for most of the major utilities. And most of the fuel that comes into the region really comes through Portland, which is going to be heavily impacted. Critical facilities, again, hospitals, they predict up to 4 months before they're really fully usable. Fire stations and police stations, about the same. Schools, 1 to 18 months. So any subduction zone earthquake like this will leave us devastated for a long period of time. And this is a picture of Japan 2 years after the earthquake. So this is something we will be dealing with for many, many years. And just to mention real quickly, that's not the only hazard we face. These are some of the hazardous materials facilities in Gresham that I put up on a map for you. There's lots of them. I think we have 24 extremely hazardous substance sites, if I'm not mistaken. And we have, the typical weather emergencies, like the chief mentioned back in 2008. That was as small of a thing as you can call a disaster, and it really took its toll on our city for several weeks, actually. Even after the snow melted, everybody trying to get back on track. So, and then we have a lot of other hazards to face as well. And with that, I think Gresham Resources, I'll have to let it go. All right, and you're at the bottom of that pyramid, by the way, to take care of your own preparedness, and there's our contact information. Sorry about that, I got a little long-winded.
So you see Todd's contact number and his email on there, and of course Kelly Landefazzo, who's here as well, assists him in the same endeavors. And as you mentioned, there's a lot of resources available at the City of Gresham. We're here to serve you, and I appreciate your presentation. A lot of information, real short, condensed time. I apologize for cutting you short. Got to keep everybody on the timeline. So do appreciate the info, Todd, and thanks for being here today. Folks, next up we have Bill Nicholson. He's the Senior Vice President from Portland General Electric. As a Senior VP, he currently oversees customer service operations, strategy, and business customer development, along with transmission and distribution operation services. A registered professional engineer, he joined PGE in 1980 as an engineer at the Trojan plant, served in a variety of capacities in distribution operations and general engineering. So, he's earned a bachelor's degree in nuclear engineering from Oregon State University and has successfully completed the Harvard... Oh, we got some beavers out there. At least... Oh, there we go. Any ducks?
Yeah.
I apologize, ma'am. Completed the Harvard University Program on Negotiation, the Utility Executive Program from the University of Idaho, and the American Leadership Forum, where he serves as Senior Fellow. We really appreciate him being here today and spending some time with us. And the question I'd like you to consider is a question that I'm sure that we all have, and it's a pretty natural question, and I know you've dealt with it, and this will be like a softball toss. So, PGE plays an absolute critical role during an emergency, whether it's snow and ice or a large-scale disaster. Can you please tell us how you work with business customers to ensure that they can open doors following an incident? Ladies and gentlemen, VP of General Electric, Bill Nicholson, Senior Vice President.
Thank you, sir.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here, and Todd sets a table like that with the impacts and remind us how tough it might be, it certainly puckers people like me up, because I'm responsible for any power outage that you have or any customer complaint that you have, and we expect to have a few of those should those that event happen. But I do think that this earthquake focus has been a great galvanizing thing for us in our community to motivate us to action, because when we have the occasional event every few years, snow event or whatever it is, you know, we have pretty short memories. But now that we realize what could happen here, it's motivating to us as a company, it's motivating to me as an individual. And if it's not the earthquake, it could also be a terrorist attack, it could be a flood, it could be a lot of things that lead to similar outcomes. So I think it's great to use this as a bookend for us to plan for, and that's something PGE is doing. One of the good things, if you can call it that, for us is that we have small emergencies on a regular basis. We have at 3 a.m. cars hitting a pole, and we have emergency safety situations, and we have people responding 24/7. Then every once in a while, like 2008, we have a snowstorm that knocks us all down for a week. And actually just this fall, we had what were major to us and to some of you, three major storm events that had about 100,000 or more customers impacted each event. Each of those events, we opened our emergency operations center, and we worked on emergency response. So we get practice on a regular basis, but not for something like what Todd was describing. So for us, the main focus for us when we have any kind of event is prioritization and focus on the highest things first. And it always starts with public safety. And just as a reminder, any down line could kill you. Even if you think it's not a power line, it's a phone line, or even if you think it's definitely dead and not energized, make sure that you don't come close to it, and nobody does until we get there to make it safe. That's our number one concern. In our recent snowstorm of 2008, we had 1,500 power lines down at once, within 24 hours, and we were responding to how to deal with those. So that's our number one. Once we address all those public safety concerns, which sometimes takes a day or so before we can really get to the real restoration, we try and get the most people back as soon as possible. So that's generating facilities, transmission lines, on down to our substations, which get down to maybe feeding 10,000 people at a time, then on to distribution lines that feed about 3,000 people at a time, then to individual neighborhoods of a few hundreds, and then down to your back lot, single service. I apologize, you may be the last one of 100,000 customers to get back in power, or your business if you're one of the one that in which we can't get lots of people back. That's why it's prioritized in that way. However, what we want you to do, especially in your businesses, is if you have unique needs, we count on you to call us to our through our Emergency Operations Center and our key customer managers like John Maloney and then Dean Funk, working with our government and municipal partners. that's where we reprioritize. And we don't just go by pure numbers, but we go by environmental, potential environmental impacts or safety impacts or needs to coordinate with others to get the community served. So this is a general prioritization we use, but then we use our ongoing communications with you to improve our response. One of the things that we've been focusing on the last few years more than anything is our own employee preparedness, because we can't get your power back if our employees are at home running around trying to find food and water for their family. So it's been a major focus for us, and in partnership with the Red Cross, it's been fantastic where we've been able to help our own employees get more prepared. I liked Lynn's story about the generator. In 2008, during that snowstorm, as the snow was starting, I thought, I'm not prepared, I'm gonna go buy a generator. So I went to Home Depot, I got an 8 kilowatt generator because I felt like I need a big one. I'm with a power company, I wanna help my neighbors more than anything. And so I got that generator home. By then there were 6 inches of snow on the ground, and I could not even move that generator from my car to my house to make it do any good. So that's how prepared I was in 2008. So I've been giving it a lot of thought since then, as has our company. So one of the things that I would ask all of you today is, if you don't have an emergency kit in your car right now, if your significant other or family members don't have an emergency, at least a three-day kit, maybe better, but at least a three-day kit in your car right now, and if you don't have a kit at home, you are not ready, and you're not going to be able to help your own business get out of the soup, because you're going to worry about your family first. And that's what we tell our employees. Make sure your family's safe. You can't go to work until your family is safe. So partnering with the Red Cross, we've been getting our employees and myself buy these kits online, or if you want to make it up yourself, you can do that. That's number one. Number two is we need to be ready as a company. A few things we've been doing is really enhancing our incident command structure, which the fire service and governments have been using for many years. We've had that in place for about 10 years now, but we're continuing to hone that and expand that to other parts of our company so that any single facility could isolate themselves and operate as an independent emergency center, and they would know how to coordinate and communicate with outside entities and internal to the company. Another thing we have done just in the last year and a half or so is we've opened a new readiness center in Clackamas County, which will allow us to evacuate our downtown headquarters, where we have our key operations for running our power plants, for running our transmission distribution system, our security, our information technology. All of our systems are run downtown, guess what? On a Cascadia subduction zone area that will liquefy because it's right next to the Willamette River, and it's going to be down. And we have been exposed for many years, but we now have a new center up and available that we will go to for those emergency operations that's in a different soil condition. It is built to a 9.0 earthquake, and we now have a place to go to should the worst happen. So that's a key readiness thing that we have also done. In terms of encouraging you as businesses, what should you do? The first thing I would encourage you is to do what we're encouraging our employees. Make sure you and your employees are prepared so that their families are going to be okay and they can come right to work. We can't, and none of us can afford 24 hours of all of us running around getting our families safe before we come back to work should the worst happen. So that would be number one. And again, partnership with the Red Cross and going to the Red Cross website is what we've encouraged our employees to do. It's what I've done myself. Secondly, if you have critical power needs that you can't be without for a few hours, you probably already have a backup generator, but you might consider that to be self-sufficient for some period of time before we're possibly going to be able to get to you. We're all going to have to be more self-sufficient. We have a 100 megawatts of collective standby generators across our service area that we've partnered with our customers on, to where we maintain and operate those generators on behalf of the customer. And when we need it for a peak emergency, we can press a button and start up everybody's emergency diesel generators and run them for the benefit of the grid. But we also make sure they're reliable for the immediate need of the customers. So if you have a generator and you haven't thought of that, you might fit into our program for that. But being self-sufficient is the first thing after making sure your employees are ready. And the other thing, like I had mentioned before, we want to hear from you. If you have a unique need, as you're thinking, sitting here today, we want to know about it. But certainly during an emergency condition or just a, quote, regular storm where we have power outages going on, we want to know from you if there's something going on so that we can meet that need. We'll prioritize that among all of our other needs, and that's what our Emergency Operations Center is all about. So that's, I guess, the last thing I would say. In addition, we are running some community events, kind of similar to this, where we are trying to get more of the operations people together so that we're better connected to the right people in government and in private industry that are infrastructure providers and be able to talk the same language, know who's who, and share information. So we're continuing to hold those kind of forums across our service area and plan to do more. So with that, I would just say thank you for your interest, and when, as you walk out of here today, I would just remind you, start with yourself. Make sure you and your family are ready, and we'll all be better off. So, thanks.
Thank you, Bill, and please pass on to all your employees how much they're appreciated by all of us. They do a great job for us in the community, and on behalf of the firefighters too, we rely heavily on them to keep us safe. So in a fire call at a regular house, they come pull the meter so that we don't deal with that charged electricity. And you're always so quick to respond. We appreciate you keeping us safe. And thanks again for being here and all that you do. So next up, we have Kevin Jeffries. Kevin Jeffries comes to us from the Oregon Insurance Division. He's been with the Oregon Department of Consumer and Business Services Insurance Division since 2011. DCBS is Oregon's largest consumer protection and business regulator. Perhaps you've heard of them. My guess is you have, maybe in an email that comes from sometimes some legislative folks. We appreciate the work they do. As the division's consumer liaison, Kevin's primary role is to represent consumers to the division's senior policy team and to keep the insurance commissioner up to date on consumer-specific issues. So he also served as communications director and legislative assistant to three state legislators prior to becoming an employee of DCBS. In addition, Kevin's also a familiar face, but he's a city councilor for the city of McMinnville. He loves most about his job, besides working with the best team in state government. It's his ability to join three great passions: education, public policy, and consumer protection. He has a BA and master's from the Western Oregon University, and he's joining us today. So without further ado, Kevin, what I'd like you to consider when you come to the podium is the idea of insurance as a no-brainer in the business world. We all know we've got to have it. It saves us a lot. Are you finding that businesses in Oregon are properly covered in anticipation of a disaster? And so with that, ladies and gentlemen, from DCBS, the Oregon Insurance Division, this is Kevin Jeffries. Kevin? It's a bit of an obstacle course. Just jump over one into the other. Thanks for being here. Good to see you again.
You too. Well, that's a really good question. Whether or not you are all prepared, I think the best way to answer that is a show of hands. Who here believes that they're prepared for a disaster with insurance? There you go. There's your answer. And that's somewhat consistent with what we're hearing at the insurance division. At the insurance division, we have a team of consumer advocates that respond to consumer complaints. And the most common complaint that we get stems from the fact that the consumer didn't have the coverage that they thought they had. They had homeowners insurance, and they had if they had an earthquake or a water damage or from a flood, they assumed that was going to be covered, but it's not. And the same applies to businesses. So I'm going to talk a little bit, start off about the insurance division and the Department of Consumer Business Services. Well, first of all, this is a really great consumer guide that we've developed, and the whole point of this guide is to help businesses as they grow to make sure that they are covering their liabilities and their assets properly. The genesis for this guide came from a business in McMinnville that, you know, how many of you remember that peanut recall a couple years back? Okay, they were a food manufacturing company, and they started off as a little mom and pop shop, well, just a mom, she's a single mother, and in her garage, and her company grew. But as her company grew, she didn't really insure the growth. And during that recall, she had products that were being sold into the UK. About 60% of her sales were into Europe and into Scotland and Australia. Well, when the recall happened, she had recall insurance, but only for domestic sales. All that stuff that was foreign wasn't included. And had she informed her agent, she would have been paying a little bit more in premiums, but she would have gotten a lot back in recoveries from that incident. So that's what that guide's about. And unfortunately, there's a whole section in there about health insurance and Cover Oregon. It needs to be updated. So I don't have any copies with me, but that's going to be updated on our website, which you can find at www.insurance.oregon.gov. Okay, so DCBS, as I want to say Representative Matthews said, Greg Matthews said, that this is Oregon's largest business regulatory and consumer protection agency. This is really, and the insurance division is part of that. Workers' comp, OSHA is also part of that. And the insurance division is really Oregon's best kept secret. I'm going to go back a second. Last year, the insurance division recovered almost $2.25 million in unpaid claims to consumers, which means the consumer filed a complaint or filed a claim with their insurance company, whether it be an auto policy or a homeowner's or health, and the insurance company denied it or disputed the actual costs involved. Well, the consumer then contacts us, files a complaint, and we investigate it, and we lead the insurance companies oftentimes to what we call self-discovery. Point at their contract and say, you're entitled to pay according to this, and they follow their contract. On the rare occasion where they disagree with us, we are the regulatory authority here, and we can force them to pay restitution. And so when we come knocking, the insurance companies listen. Show of hands, how many insurance agents do we have in the room today, insurance companies? All right. These are good guys, okay? Hopefully they're all licensed to sell. And if they're not, come talk to me. Something I always ask people, audiences, how many of you have read your insurance policy, whether it be your health insurance, your business liability insurance policy from end to end? Okay. The agents, of course. Okay. How many of you, show of hands, rely on your agent to perform that duty for you and give you sound advice? Okay. That's pretty standard. So of you that just raise your hands, how many of you have checked to make sure that that agent is licensed to give you that advice? Okay. Check to make sure they're licensed. Most of them are. I'd say most of the agents in Oregon are they're licensed and they're up to date on all their training and they're doing a great job. In fact, we've seen a decline in agent complaints. But if you're going to rely on them to give you sound advice, make sure that they're licensed. Make sure that they're up to date on all of their. Yes? Do you have a question? Or 5 minutes? Okay. I used to teach, so when I see a hand go up, I just immediately think. So it's really important that you check to make sure they're licensed and up to date on all their education. So again, this is some of the stuff that's covered in that guide, and I don't have any copies with me, but definitely recommend you go and check it out. Okay, so a couple of things you can think about as you're talking with an agent about insurance, which is the whole point of that guide, is to give you the information to go and be an informed consumer. So business property insurance is something you would need if you've had a fire. The items inside of that facility would be covered through that. If you have a flood, you have flood insurance, it's great, but it doesn't always cover the products inside your business. And so it's important that you have property insurance and it actually does cover the items inside. If you change your inventory and you now have a new piece of equipment, make sure your insurance company knows that piece of equipment's there. Business interruption insurance is vital. If you have a fire, that insures the structure and the property inside. But what if you have, in this case, you have a bakery, and you have a wedding. Okay, they're expecting a cake, they're expecting cupcakes, they're expecting all this stuff, and they have a deposit. You want to keep your business going. Well, with business interruption insurance, you can actually get a facility and rent all the equipment, and the insurance company will pay for all those additional costs so that you can keep your business running. Key person's life insurance. Now, in the event of an emergency or some catastrophe, somebody in your business might not be able to make it. You might lose staff. Somebody might die. And with this, you're able to go out and hire somebody to keep the business going. And if you're going to do that, don't tell your partner you're doing that. They might get nervous. But you can take a policy out on your partner. So what risks do we face? Well, in Oregon, we have several. We have floods, we have earthquakes, we have fires, and we have snowstorms and things like that. And I want to talk a little bit about some of these risks. So we can do a lot to avoid risks, but risks happen, emergencies happen. And And so it's important that we do everything we can to prevent those incidents that we're prepared to respond. So flood insurance is a really important tool for you all to consider. I know even if you're in a low to moderate zone, it's fairly inexpensive. I think if you're just gonna insure the items inside, like I say you're renting a facility, the rates for those start at about, I wrote it down somewhere, about $160, $183 a month to insure all your items inside in the event, even in the event of a flood. And that gives you $50,000 worth of coverage. And that most of the area, I think, around Gresham is in a low to moderate flood area. If you have a mortgage on your facility, they're going to require you to have flood insurance if you're in a high risk area. So there's a difference in flood insurance. This is a question we get a lot. A flood versus a slide. So flood insurance will cover it if you can stand in it. If you can stand on it, it's a slide. And there's no coverage for that. In fact, you probably have to go to Lloyd's of London in order to get a coverage for any landslides. Moving earth is not covered under your homeowner's policy, under an earthquake policy, which is often the cause of the slide. Earthquake insurance, again, is not covered under your standard policy. You would have to go out and get a specific earthquake insurance. And again, it's not covered under your policy. And the deductibles, again, is a percentage of what you've covered. So something to consider. I'm running out of time, so I'm kind of going through this quick. The other thing about earthquake insurance is that there's a moratorium on it. Once you've had an earthquake, you can't go out and buy it for quite a while. Because there's aftershocks and things like that. So the best time to buy it is now. So again, always make sure, some tips, always make sure your agent's licensed and keep your agent up to date on all the items you have in your store and things like that. Ask questions and don't leave until you have a good feeling about what you've purchased. And the last thing I want to leave you with is your communities depend on you to keep your doors open. As we look at Katrina, as we looked at Hurricane Sandy, the first thing that the people would look at to see if a community was bouncing back is, are the stores open? And if you're not ready to come back, your community won't come back either. And in the terms of flood insurance, 25% of businesses that close after a flood never come back because they didn't have insurance. So your community is depending on you to be prepared. And I am out of time. Thank you.
Kevin Jeffries, thank you, Kevin, for being here today and making the drive in. And also thanks for your service in your community in McMinnville. Keep up the good work. So it's not just about like being prepared in that fashion, but there's also a lot of data out there that suggests that you better have your data backed up. So if you think about your invoices that are unpaid at this point, if you were to lose track of all of those invoices, you would not only lose some business in the very first few weeks of the emergency, but you could potentially lose a great deal of revenue too. So there's a lot of reasons to be prepared, and insurance is just one of those many things to make sure you're covered. Next up, we have from U.S. Bank, Kelly Piper. So, did anybody here know that U.S. Bank is the fifth largest commercial bank in the United States? Anybody know that? You knew that. Yeah. I've been with them forever. We're pleased to have Kelly. She's the Director of Emergency Management for U.S. Bank. She's here today, and this is Kelly Piper. She has more than 35 years in the financial industry, so you can imagine what it was like, a bit overwhelming at 5 years old, to be hired to do such a big job. The experience of providing comprehensive incident management. She's responsible for identification and oversight of major unpredictable events worldwide that threaten to harm the organization, its employees, or its facilities. She's also currently the treasurer for the Oregon Emergency Management Association and a member of International Association of Emergency Managers. So, Kelly, while you make your way to the podium, I'd like you to consider this. Could you please tell us how your business or your agency prepares its operations and employees for the disaster or the emergency? And once again, thank you very much. Kelly Piper, U.S. Bank.
Thank you.
So I just, first of all, want to mirror Bill Nicholson. You couldn't have said it better, that preparing your employees is the number one thing that you can do, because the quicker your employees can return back to work, the quicker you'll be business as usual. So that is huge, and thank you. You couldn't have said it better. I also want to compliment Todd and Kevin with insurance, earthquake insurance. It is cheap. I've had it for years. Most people that I ask don't have it, don't know it exists. It is extra. You have to go out and buy it, but it's like pennies on the dollar. So definitely go out and get earthquake insurance. And I can talk about the other stuff later. Okay. So, emergencies, incidents, disasters, they come in all different forms. The first ones we know are natural. They're the sexy ones. They're the tornadoes, the floods, the fires, the ones that everybody's been talking about that people are familiar with. Other ones are chemical spills, are train derailments that have been happening, it seems like, every single day recently, bridge collapses, those things that you don't think about, but those are disasters. And finally, security, robberies, riots, protests, they impact all of our businesses. So you have to consider all of those emergencies, not just fire and flood and earthquakes. So this is a quick snapshot of it's our crisis declaration process at U.S. Bank, but it's a general one that can be used for anything. Along the obviously you see the big incident that occurs up in the upper left-hand corner. If you go down the left-hand side, that's what immediately happens after an incident. You evacuate your employees. You take a damage assessment. You look at the health and welfare of all your employees. You're doing all that stuff at the same time. So somebody's called 911. Somebody has called hopefully a security control center that you have, and in the background, my job is to contact the site leader at that location where the incidents happened. Find out, are there all the employees okay? What's happening with the facility? How can we assist you? So there's multiple things going on at once, and this is sort of a snapshot. So along the left is what you see and hear when you're involved in the incident, but in the background, we're getting the support teams together to bring your business back to normal. So priorities. People, property, reputation. If you don't take away anything else from this, that's your priority. People are number one, and we've said it a number of times. If you can't get your people back to work, it's for naught. I don't care if you can restore your services and you can, find your invoices and you've got insurance. If you don't have anybody to run your company, it's not going to do any good. So your first priority is people. It's accountability. It's knowing where they are. Can you reach them after an incident? Is it after hours? Do you have everybody's phone numbers, written down instead of in your phone? Can you reach them? Are they prepared? Can they restore their own, home and their building and their family, and can they return to work immediately? So people is number one. Obviously property, you want to make sure that your facility is prepared and that you have the insurance and that you have everything prepared, but that's secondary after people. And then finally, reputation. People don't think about it, but reputation is huge, and that can ruin your business. So if your reputation is damaged, your business can be damaged. So people, property, reputation, think about those. And I speak really quickly, so I'm going to go through this quickly, and I'll make up for all the time that everybody else talked over. Emergency response teams. So this is what we call it at U.S. Bank, emergency response team. These are the floor wardens, the safety wardens, the people that do the sweeping and, escort you out the building when there's a fire drill, when there's an emergency drill. They're also site leaders. They're the people that we can contact at the location to say, what's going on? Give me a status of the incident. How are your people? What's going on with the property? Give us updates. Those are established at U.S. Bank across the world. And as he said, it's a global footprint. So I'm responsible for the 125 large locations here in the domestically that have 75 or more employees, and we're also in 9 countries. And now, unfortunately, I don't get to travel to all those countries, but I'm working on it. Communication tools. After accounting for your people, communication is the number one reason why you're going to fail. You have to establish multiple means of communication. So these are just samples of some of the things we have. A site mass mailing. So that is an email distribution list for all of your companies. And I know some of your companies are small, some are larger, but have something automated. Have something dynamic so that all you have to do is click one button or have one, form of emailing everybody at your location at once. Because during an incident, you don't want to be trying to think about who else you have to include in the email. Have that dynamic and have it set up ahead of time and test it. emergency notification system. This is a more sophisticated automatic system, and if your company's small, you may not have it, but you can set something up on your cell phone. That's the system that, you know, calls people, emails them, texts them, pages them. It's whatever they can do to get a hold of the person, and then has a recorded message to say, you know, there's been an incident, you know, here's what to do. So people call into the system and hear that message. Another option for that is, I call it a hazard hotline. It's simply a phone with an answering machine on it. It's a way to leave a message. So if you can get the message out to everybody, there's been an incident, our building's been impacted, we're, you know, under 6 feet of water, call the hazard hotline every 2 hours for an update. Then it's your job to update that recording every 2 hours, but your employees can call in and get that information so that you're not having to remember to call all, you know, 42 people or however many you have. So have those systems in place and test them so that you have that communication tool. As I said before, communication plus rumors start, you know, spreading around if the communication isn't good. If you've got Sally sitting at home and she said, I heard our building was flooded, but I haven't, you know, heard anything. Maybe something horrible happened. Maybe, you know, this happened. And so people's minds start to wander. They start to talk to their friends. Rumors get out of control, and it's, you know, it's out of control before you know it. You as the leader have to set the stage. You have to send that accurate and concise message to all your employees so that they know exactly what's going on. And I'm not speaking fast enough. Okay. Be prepared before it happens. This is basic preparedness information. I won't go through each one, but know your surroundings. Know what's going on. Train your employees to be aware of their surroundings at any given time. It's not a roll call when you evacuate. You're not going to sit and go down through a list to make sure everybody's there. That doesn't work. It's the opposite of approach. You have to make sure that people know who's around them at any given time. So if there's an evacuation right now, right this instant, we evacuate. I know Todd's sitting right next to me. If we go out to our evacuation assembly point and Todd's not there, there's something wrong. I'm going to report that Todd's not there. That's what the philosophy we have to get used to, is that people have to report missing or injured people, not checking in, yeah, I'm here. We know the people that are there. They're standing there. It's the people that are missing or injured that we want to account for. Shake it up a little bit. People are used to taking the same exits for evacuation each and every time. I always go out the south door. Well, what if the south door is blocked? What if there's a fire? If you have evacuation drills, block that exit. Make people think on their feet. Make people think, you know, this isn't a standard. It's going to be smoky. It's going to be chaotic. There's going to be noise. Maybe you won't be able to hear. So you have to train people that it's not like we're in grade school. Everybody stands up, goes out in the parking lot, checks in, and then comes back in. It's not like that. So we have to get people thinking about that. Fourth anniversary of Japanese earthquake. And this I think sort of sums it up. This is right after it happened. It just didn't impact the Japanese people. It impacted us across the whole West Coast. I was on many conference calls talking about what's going to happen when the tsunami hits. We have many branches along the, you know, the coastline that might have been impacted. Luckily, that didn't happen. But it's devastating. The Japanese people are still being impacted today, as we are with the plastic washing up on our beaches. But it's devastating. And this could be an earthquake. This could be us in the Northwest after a 9.0 earthquake. And it's as simple as winter storms. And this is in, where was this? In the Midwest last winter. I don't remember where it was. I can't remember where the picture was taken. But anyway, it can be any city at any time. You know, snowstorms can bring people down. So just think about it. It's not just the big sexy ones. It's the simple things. There's my information. If you have any questions, I'm available. I think everybody's going to get a copy of the presentation when you're done. So thank you for having me. And
thank you, Kelly. 35 years. It must have been a blur as fast as you go. Good for you. That's excellent information, and thanks so much. And thank you again for U.S. Bank, fifth largest bank in the nation. That's great. And she brought up a great point about drills. You know, evacuation drills are an important aspect of that. We do them at the city of Gresham. It's oftentimes unannounced. It's always best when they're unannounced. When they are announced, you get people waiting by the door. They plan their coffee break. They do whatever they do. It's good to have them unannounced. You may have employees in your building. Maybe they're not your employees. Maybe they're others that need a little extra assistance. It's good to find those things out because it makes you aware of what you have to do each and every time to help your fellow citizen in the emergency. I can tell you, it's an awkward feeling as a firefighter to walk out of a building because the alarm's going off. That's really rare. But even the firefighters participate in our fire drills. They go put their clothes on, they go back in, but we'll figure it out. anyway, do drill, do train, and do practice, and block an exit. Make something unavailable. Make it awkward. Make it odd. Don't let people get too familiar. And with that, our next speaker comes from an agency that, through my career of whether it be military, police, or fire, I have seen countless times serve the community, serve our country, serve other countries. They are all over the map. They're all over the world. If you were to access their site, it would tell you to donate now and tell you how you can do that. It could also give you volunteer opportunities. But all I can tell you is when we call, they show up each and every time for our citizens experiencing the disaster of their day. And again, oftentimes we respond to citizens' worst moments, and they're there to make it better each and every time. So much respect for the organization of the American Red Cross, and today we have our Chief Executive Officer, Amy Shlossman. She joined the American Red Cross as the Chief Executive Officer of the Cascades Region in August 2014. She began her career in the Arizona nonprofit community, leading youth development and service learning programs, then moved to the Director of Policy in Arizona Governor Napolitano's office. Wow. I'd rather say Brown. I'm kidding. Governor Napolitano, keep up the great work. Amy worked with 40 state agencies. You don't know how electeds operate sometimes. Huh? 40 state agencies to balance the state's budget and implement new initiatives. Nonprofit, community, state level experience, and didn't stop there. Chief of Staff of the White House Office of Management and Budget, helped manage the federal office responsible for developing the president's annual budget and setting fiscal and management policies for more than 100 agencies across the executive branch. Yes, that's true. She's a pretty big deal. I don't know how many people you know that work directly for the President of the United States, but now we know one, and we're pleased to have her. So we're very blessed to have her talent, her experience put to great use with us today. So as you make your way to the podium, Amy, I would like to ask you the following question. It sounds as though the Red Cross is willing and open to working closely with businesses. Can you expand on just how we can partner with you in the future before we really need to partner? So with that, the Chief Executive Officer of the American Red Cross, this is Amy Shlossman. Amy?
All right. I know we are short on time, so I am going to jump to the meat of our presentation, which is all the great information that our speakers shared today and many of the businesses that we partner with both in this room and at our speakers table, which are great community partners for the Red Cross. What types of tools can we give you, and can we work with local businesses to provide to your employees? So we'll go right into our business resilience programming. And a lot of this we covered in the other presentations, so we'll send this out, but you're not missing a whole lot. All right. So the Red Cross has been in the arena of preparedness and disaster response for many, many years. And we're not new to this in this region. We obviously face an array of different hazards and risks that are unique to the Pacific Northwest and are also unique to businesses across the country. And so our business leaders resilience programming is really focused on working with local businesses to give you the tools that you need to prepare before disasters strike. Because as our speaker have shared, the more prepared you are, the more likely that you will be able to bounce back and open those doors after a disaster. So the first component of this is working within industries to work together, to strategize around strategies to plan and to share resources and to learn from each other. And so this is an effort that we are proud to have launched this past fall in conjunction with PGE. It's our Industry Leaders Program. And we launched this last November, bringing together businesses like yourselves to learn from emergency managers at some of our largest companies across Oregon. And so we did this event in November and had another one a few months ago with Tektronix, where we basically do a business continuity and preparedness 101 seminar. It's about 2 hours long, and we go through a lot of the fundamentals that Kelly talked about and that Bill talked about so that every business leader is able to walk out of that session and have the basics of what they need to do to go back and prepare at their place of business. Now, of course, it doesn't stop there. The key that all of our speakers emphasize today is making sure that your employees are prepared. This is hands down the most valuable thing that a business can do, because your employees are not going to come back after a disaster if their families aren't taken care of and if they don't have the plans in place to make sure that their families are safe. And so there are a couple of different programs that the Red Cross offers focusing on basic preparedness and advanced training. So basic preparedness is very easy. It's about going in, and the Red Cross offers this, and we will come to you. You can come to us, whatever is the most convenient, and talk to employees about being prepared. Talk about the local risks and hazards that we face. Talk about the importance of being informed about those local risks. Talk about how easy it is to make a plan, how easy it is to build a kit or buy a kit. And so just very basic programming that we can go in and under an hour and do some hands-on training with your employees. And then, of course, there's the advanced training, which the Red Cross also offers. You may have seen, as I was flipping through this the slides, we know that the ratio of first responders to everyday citizens, there's a big difference in between. One firefighter for every 275 people, one EMT for every 380 people. And so you're looking at a big gap in capacity if there is a large-scale disaster that our emergency responders need to respond to. But there are basic skills that every person can learn and can have to be able to respond. Basic Red Cross CPR and first aid and AED training. We have wilderness first aid. We have pets first aid. We have basic babysitting classes, lifeguarding classes. So these are all just everyday great skills for your workforce to have. And these, again, are classes that the Red Cross is happy to come into your places of business, into the community, and provide these skills to your employees. A new program that we just started that came out of our business resilience programming, it's again about an hour and a half to 2 hour program where we come in and we do a basic preparedness 101 overview for your employees. We teach basic citizen CPR. So this is the hands-only CPR. We know that it saves lives. It's easy to learn, it's easy to teach, and everybody walks away with a life-saving skill. And then the third part of this program is interactive exercises around disaster kit building. So we do relay races, we make it fun, we get people up and running around, and everybody's able to walk away with a preparedness kit to put in their car, to put under their desk, to leave at home. So this is a great exercise and that hits on each of the core components of our disaster preparedness education. And then there are many resources that the Red Cross offers in conjunction with companies like yours across the state. We have a lot of handouts at our Red Cross table right over here, and I encourage everyone to take a look. There are two pieces that I would encourage everyone to pick up. The first is our prepare guide, and I unfortunately did not walk up on stage with one, but excellent, right there. This is about a 20-page document that goes through step-by-step guide about all of our local hazards and risks that we face in this region, from what to do in an earthquake to how to prepare your family for a home fire or how to build a preparedness kit. So it's a how-to encyclopedia, mini encyclopedia, for disaster preparedness. And it's a free guide that we're happy to give to any company to bring to your employees. The other handout that is our business resilience guide. And this walks through a lot of the programming that we've just talked about and a lot of the different tools and resources that the Red Cross offers to local businesses. And so those two pieces of paper are great takeaways when you walk away from here and are great tools for and easy steps to train your workforce. So I think we've talked about most of these. One other thing I would draw attention to is the Ready Rating System Assessment. How many of you have heard of this? Okay, good, excellent. So the Ready Rating Assessment is an online tool, free online tool for businesses that basically walks you through a series of different questions to evaluate your business's preparedness and then makes very helpful suggestions about areas where you can put plans in place and take steps to enhance your preparedness. This is a free tool available online and is a great resource to businesses that are small and large. So would encourage everyone to take a look at that, and we also have more information about that at our table. That wraps up, and I think I may speak even more quickly than Kelly, the basic resources that the Red Cross offers in the community. I would just want to conclude by saying what valuable partners both PGE and U.S. Bank are to the Red Cross. We do work very closely together with your senior leadership teams, with your employees, and it makes me feel good that we have some of our major employers in the state are so prepared and are taking these steps to make sure that their employees are ready to respond as well. So with that, I will leave the rest of the time, I think, to Q&A, and happy to answer any questions.
We were just debating on how much time we might have remaining, and it's not a lot, but we will take questions if there are any out there in the field. So anybody have any questions for a specific panel member that you'd like to ask today, something that you think might be good for the others to hear? Obviously, you can take questions one-on-one if you'd like afterwards, but this might be something. If you have a question for the group, we'd love to hear from you. Anybody?
Best question is a trip to Hawaii sponsored by Doug Walker Travel.
We don't really know that. Shelly just held up that she has three questions. So before, oh, was that the minute timing? Okay, that makes more sense.
There's Jim right there.
Oh, great, yes. Superintendent Jim Schlachter.
This could be for any one of you. Relative to schools, over the years, long ago, there were efforts to prepare for emergencies by having big steel containers filled with all kinds of little snacks and treats, small kits to comfort children, whatever. Over time, those were impossible to maintain, to keep fresh, and to manage. So we pretty much do not have those anymore. What's the current thinking on preparedness for schools for a disaster?
Okay. There are still some schools, primarily along the coast, that do have.
Todd, take the microphone.
Sorry. Thought I was being loud enough. There are still some schools, primarily along the coast, that do have containers like that. In our area, with the population and that type of thing, that has really not been much of an effort here. Most of our work, and I do work with a group called the School Emergency and Response and Recovery Alliance, and it works on emergency planning and things like that for the East County schools. Most of our work has been in the way of training and exercising, not so much as in supplies. So we work really closely with the schools in those types of ways.
And what I would say is same thing with employees, prepare your kids. Kids can have a pack back they take with them that they, you know, take every day that has supplies with them. So prepare your kids.
Thank you. Anybody else have any other questions you'd like to ask? Great question from our superintendent. No more questions? Wow. Well, great. Well, just please know this. If you have a question specific to your business, your needs, your family, your employees, please do contact the individual representatives on our panel. They've done an outstanding job for us today. And with that, I will turn it back over to Madam President. Lynn Snodgrass, please.
Thank you. I kind of feel like I drank from a fire hose. How about the rest of you? And not because Greg was up here, but there was a lot of information. Well, that's your typical, but there was a lot of information. I have the one nugget theory when I go to a conference or a panel discussion like this. There are so many things that we could do, so much that we learned today, but I try to accomplish one nugget. I write them all down, but then I try to accomplish that one nugget. So I'm hoping that all of you are thinking about one thing that you could do and check off your list today. Obviously, there's lots that we could do based on what we heard. The forum was jam-packed. Thank you all so much for participating. In the Garden Center world, we have a saying that the best... The best day to plant a tree was 50 years ago. The second best day is today. The same goes with disaster preparedness. The best time to prepare was a long time ago. The second best time is this afternoon when you get back to the office. So I would encourage you to do that. Thank you to Greg. Greg, you did a great job putting this together. Thank you so much. A hand for Greg Matthews, our fire chief. And our panelists, Bill, I'm not going to be calling on you anytime soon to help me with any husband things, because that generator and that 8 inches of snow is going to be a visual I'm going to have for a long time. Please thank our great panel, please, again. Thank you so much for your time today. I'd also like to thank our sponsors again, Frontier, PGE, City of Portland, Gresham Sanitary, ServPro, and Day Wireless. Please thank them again. And on behalf of the board and the members, all of the members of the chamber, I would like to thank all of you for attending the Gresham Area Chamber Business Forum. All right, drive carefully and let's get busy getting prepared.